So our family right here, this is what we got to start with. I think I'm probably my family's like the youngest cousin in here, it's safe to say. But we got work to do. You know what I'm saying? I listen to pastor talk every time. I listen to how y'all talk and things we got to come with. We got work to do. You know what I'm saying? Y'all can't hold us up forever. Somebody got to take over. You know what I'm saying? Y'all looking good and y'all doing y'all thing right here. And that's a blessing. Because y'all have the years. And y'all have the experience. And y'all ain't never changed throughout those years. That's a blessing.
Amen.
People don't have that. So we have to learn from y'all. We have to recreate that. And that's the way we got to do it, staying close to y'all. And God's not going to let that fail because we know y'all plans and y'all goals. He's not going to let that fail. So y'all do have people behind you. Y'all do have people looking up to y'all and trying to see what they can do, you know, to come fill y'all's shoes. But for everybody in here, man, life is short. You don't know who's going to be gone. So many times I should have been gone. And be here to talk to you now. So, I mean, that's what I look at. And I come with the things I did, what I did to, and the things I'm doing now, where I'm going to. You know, and when I weigh those options, like what I'm saying, there's no comparison. It's either jail or locked up or dead. I'm going to be out here being a businessman and teaching my kids. So where I want my kids to go. You know what I'm saying? What do I want to teach them? Be dead? You want to go out here and hustle? Or you want to go out here and hustle the right way? To get some business and keep it going. So it's short term and it's long dip. Which one will you have?
Yes, come on.
All right. That was all about the question. All that on the spot. He had to talk from the top of his head. Told him he wasn't short of words. All right, well, Mariko taught him real good. All right, so Brother Mariko said his grandfather taught him business principles, and Brother Mariko is making it possible for that to be passed on down the ladder. Is that good?
Amen.
Amen, it is good. Okay, I'm going to call our sister Candy, and she's going to share whatever. She probably got so many things to share, she probably don't know what to share. And then Brother Williams is going to follow her, so we're going to let them determine what's what. Sister Hill tells me, she lets me know how long I'm supposed to talk. So we're going to just let them work these things out. I never know. Okay. All right, Sister Candy. She's got some powerful testimony.
Proud of my children, and I think they know that too. But you know, what I'm really, really proud of is that the value that they put on the Word of God.
Yes.
You know, we've been hearing really, really practical things. You know, we've learned about marriages, and we're going to be talking about eating right and exercising and financial peace and all of that. But it's all based on the Word of God. And I really thank God that we set an example in our household, you know, of how to give diligence to the Word of God. And then let that Word lead us in the different things that we do in our lives and all. And I'm just so proud of the girls there and the fact that I love my sons, my new sons, praise God. But they went out on the Word, on what I taught them. And they found men that carried the values that we taught them. And what I really, really appreciate about Mariko and Walter is that they were so willing to listen to instruction. You know, sometimes, you know, you look at people who have made it and you think they've always known. And none of us started out knowing. But they were willing to sit and listen to instruction. Walter listens to Mariko instructing him in business, and Mariko listens to Donnell instructing him in business, and to his grandfather. And they listen to Pastor Hill, and they listen to us as we teach the word. And they're willing to apply that word to their lives. And it doesn't matter what the endeavor is or whatever, if you're willing to apply and to diligently search the word, you're going to have a quality of life that you didn't experience before. You know, the word, and you know, I really didn't plan to stand up and talk about the word, but I always end up back there, and I guess I just have to, because it's just where your life is. I think in Proverbs it does tell us that it'll give you life and it's healing to all your flesh. And you think of healing, you think of some miraculous thing that God's going to do and come turn around this disease or something you have, and yes, he can do that. But sometimes it's just a matter of applying the principles of the word and just letting it work. You know, as I'm listening to the instruction of God, you know, when you're in the word, you know, God talks to you, tells you the things that you need to do to be healthy, to be wealthy, to be successful, and things like that. But when you're not in the word, sometimes it kind of passes you by. You're not familiar with the language at all. But when you study the word and you give diligence to the word, instruction always comes. Wisdom always comes. Praise God. I know I was listening to Sister Irene, and I'm so proud of her, you know, her whole walk in there. And a lot of you know that this summer, or back in February, I made up my mind that, look, I struggled this long enough. I'm just going to do it. And so I decided, you know, I'm going to do it, but so many other times in my life I've decided I'm going to do it. So what's different this time? Well, what's different this time is that I have been diligently in the word, and the word doesn't let you fail. You know, and I have an example of this. I shared this with the Sunday school class a couple of weeks ago. I've been out walking, and I started out, I couldn't walk but about 3 miles, and it took me an hour and 15 or 20 minutes to walk those 3 miles. When I started doing it. Well, now I'm walking 8 miles in less than 2 hours. Praise God. But what's really, really different there is because the word is in me, I'm just not willing to accept failure anymore. And after I've been walking a while, I got up to about five or six miles a day. And I was out one day just a couple of weeks ago. And I was just at 5 or 6 miles a couple of weeks ago, and I'm at 8 now. But I was out, and because of the heat, I guess the sidewalk had shifted, and there was a difference in the sidewalk, and I stumbled and I fell. And I just started my walk, I was just very much a walk, so I went back to work, and I got first aid, and I got all cleaned up, and at work they would tell me, no, you need to sit and you be still. But in my mind, I thought, oh, no. I am more determined than I was before I failed that I'm going to get my walk in today. Praise God. Because I told them, you know, if I got to carry the scars, I got to at least say I won. Praise God. I just never let the devil win. And that's what the word does for you. It reminds you that greater is he that's in you than he is in the world. The devil doesn't win. He doesn't get to dictate our lives. He doesn't get to tell us how to eat to destroy our lives. He doesn't get to do any of that stuff. But, you know, sometimes we forget it. You know, when you're not in the word there, you forget that. And so you hear it and you don't even realize it's the devil that's telling you to do these things that are detrimental to you. Praise God. But I just thank God that the word rose up in me, and not only did I walk that day, I told them, yes, I was sore, and I was bandaged up, and as I was walking, I was kind of self-conscious because I busted both lips. And they didn't even swell the same direction. And I'm thinking, I look crazy out here. But I was walking, and the first I have a space that I do that is about 4 miles, and I do it twice. Well, I thought, well, in wisdom, I'll at least just go around the building the whole time. Well, the first time around, I was slow. But I made up in my mind that every lap that I went around, I was going to go a little bit faster, a little bit faster. Well, I realized when I got finished that I walked faster than I did before I had the accident. But it's because the word in me just let me know that, you know, devil, you cannot stop me. I told Sister Hill, because she fell the other day too. I said, the devil's just mad because we refuse to buy into that line that you got to be crippled and slow and can't get around. I told my son the other day, you can get old if you want to, but I'm not having any part of this. I'm not willing, because the word is in me, I'm just not willing to buy that lie that Satan sells to us. I'm not buying that you got to have something, because at a certain age, you know, we were at a class reunion recently, and the class members were just all amazed. You know, they were all talking about all their ailments and all. And they told Daniel, and I was talking, and they said, you don't have anything wrong with you? No. Not even high blood pressure? No. No, there's nothing wrong with me. I do not expect to be anything to be wrong with me. I will not even accept it. I would not, not only could I apply just as in the walk, I would not accept that Satan couldn't stop me from walking. Satan can't start me from being sick. Praise God. But that's because the word is in me. And you know, faith is what pleases God. And when David says that thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you, it's just that the word is just in there so that faith just rises up automatically. Praise God. And you know, sometimes, you know, just because you get saved doesn't mean the things that come. As a matter of fact, sometimes you seem to be bombarded. But your reaction to it is different when you have the word. Praise God. It doesn't get you all stressed out and out of faith. You stay in faith. And even when those situations start off, when you find yourself trying to get out of faith, the word comes back and it checks you. And it brings you in alignment. I know this week I was talking on the phone and I found out about some expense that happened that really should not have happened. And out of my mouth suddenly was about to be some wrong words coming out. But in the mid-sentence, I stopped. I said, you know what? Satan, you don't get to do this to me anymore. Praise God. You know, we talk about the power of positive confession, but we need to sometimes concentrate on the things that we're saying that's a detriment to ourselves there. You know, sometimes we speak the things into existence that happen to us sometimes. Or we react wrong and we make things go on and on and on where it could have been a simple solution. So I was kind of perplexed, you know, and my first response was to kind of mouth off and show how right I thought I was. Praise God. But you know what? It's not about me being right.
That's right.
Praise God. I don't have to be right. You know, when you realize that God is who you put your trust in,
right.
It really don't matter what I think is the way to go anywhere. And sometimes the first thought that I have is not the correct one.
Come on.
Praise God. But because I kept my mouth
yes.
closed long enough, the
yes.
correct one came.
Yes.
Praise God.
Yes.
And that's just the value of the word.
Yes, it is.
And you know what? I just love the word. I love the victory that we have in the word. And it's just so exciting, especially when I see my children applying it.
Yes.
And the principles, you know, as kids, sometimes you think, oh, here's mom and dad telling us the same thing over and over and over again. But as parents, if the word is what we're teaching, it's never out of style.
That's right.
You know, sometimes, you know, the kids might think so, but if you consistently give them the word and you tell them the way to go, you know, the Bible says train up the child in the way it goes, and when he's old, he'll not depart from it. When it's old, you know, even though they were resistant to it at times, when it came time to make the key decisions in their lives, that word rose up in them. And so I'm seeing them, you know, and they don't realize it, you know, sometimes they even look at us and think, well, I can't stay on my knees as long as mama does. I can't do this like mama does and all. But they don't realize that when I was their age, I wasn't even close to where they are now. Praise God. But the difference is they grew up with the word. And it doesn't matter when you start with the word, it works. You know, maybe you didn't grow up. I didn't grow up with the word. But the word, I have learned to value the word, and it has been such a blessing to my life.
Praise the Lord. And it's your beauty.
Amen.
I'm married up.
Amen.
<Just kidding. laughs> All right. Praise the Lord. Great. Enjoy the testimonies this morning. I asked Sister Irene, I don't know how my these old broke dudes come around my dollars. That's pretty much how it is anyway for most of us. We start off broke. Don't know anything, don't have anything. So we try and figure our way. We need some help, praise God. So I'm just going to just share some scriptures, and I don't know that even think about being up long. I'm doing some preaching, maybe just doing some talking to, because I really enjoy when I talk with Mariko and Walter, and talked with some elders, Candy and I was this week, and they said, you know, if everyone had the devotion that Jessica and Kristen has for the Lord, they would be all right too. So it takes a real commitment to God to have His grace appearing and manifested in your life, praise God. Because we're going to all start off with nothing. And I was telling my Sunday school class this morning that, you know, my class reunion, we waited 40 years to have a class reunion. And we gave ourselves 3 or 4 months to put it on and get it accomplished. And all of the lead work that it took, about 7 or 8 of us initiated. And then we speaking about our last event that we had a meeting yesterday to review and see how things came out. And even at our last event, it closed at 1 o'clock, but we still had people paying at 12:30 to get in. And we was having a good time, just seeing people all over and over and over again. When we have a class reunion, it's like, see, I grew up in the day where your neighborhood was your neighborhood. Even though it was different schools in the neighborhood and the community, you knew everybody. So when I have a class reunion, it's kind of like a family reunion. So everything, at the end of the deal, someone says, tell me about the money, how did we come up with the money? And after all the bills was paid, we had $1,100 left over in our bank account. It started with zero. So and then I said, well, shucks, if we'd have started off 40 years ago, we would have had about $100,000 in our bank account right now. Just think we could be having the next reunion in Jamaica or something. So. So you have to start. You have to start. Last week, I remember, let me give this quick testimony about my life, you know, in Monday through Friday. This is what my life kind of looks like. I'm in marketing, and I have to either sell myself, sell a product or service in order to see some money. And you have to have God working with you, and you're working with God. And I came across this guy who's in the same location, same line of work that I do. And his wife, he's a saved, spirit-filled individual, got closer to him when we were on a trip to Cancun, Candy and I. We got closer to that particular family. And he and I had already started, were already determined before we got to Cancun that we would work the market together as partners. And his past is that he has been a millionaire, a multi-millionaire. And I met him some years ago, but I just partnered up with him this year. But he had his own jet. He has his own big old house in South Tulsa, a house on the lake up by Joplin, Missouri. That's the airplane, boats, and all of that good stuff that millionaires have, plus additional assets. Now, how did he get that way? He started off with nothing. How many of us on your work on place of employment do you sign up for your benefits online? They throw you in front of a computer terminal and then you do all of this stuff. If you haven't been in the workforce in a while, you don't know nothing about that. But pretty much now, you just do everything online. It's behind a computer. I want dental, I want eyeglasses, I want major this, all that, all that. Well, that particular software that you sit down in front of, and it gets to the various insurance companies that this is what you want. He's the guy that developed that particular software. And back in the day, it was all paperwork. You had to sit down and fill out the paperwork and all like that. But he had a small agency, and he says he has a tinker in mind. And he came up with a way for that to be done online. And I forgot the insurance company, but some insurance company bought his program, the rights to that program. And now it's just an everyday thing for people to sit down at a terminal and do that. They pay them big money for that. And so he's living big and so forth. Now he's his assets are dwindling, and he wants something else to do. So he does what I do in my business. And he said, Donnell, he said, we're just not going to work together, but we're going to make $100,000 a year each together. Since partnership's not worth it unless we do that. So what am I saying is that you have to put yourself with people that are going somewhere. Even though you start off with nothing, you got to be with people that are going somewhere most days of the week. So here we go. Here we go. How many remember last week, before the offering, I told you to look up the prayer of Jabez? Yes. Yes. Anybody over there? Yes. How many did it? One person. Okay. Prayer of who?
Yes.
Prayer of Jabez. Here's a guy in his circumstances, his situation. It must have been very bad. It's when he was born. I don't know, just community, atmosphere, his family life, there was some negatives happening, and it was not a good outlook for him. That's in 1 Chronicles 4:10. Let's find it right before we get there. All right, 1 Chronicles 4:10, let's say verse 9, 1 Chronicles 4:9. Jabez was more honorable than his brethren, and his mother called his name Jabez, saying, because I bear him with sorrow. And Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that thou wouldest bless me indeed, and enlarge my coast, that thine hand might be with me, that thou wouldest keep me from what? Evil, that it may not grieve me, and God granted him that which he requested. Amen. See, Jabez is in a terrible situation. You bring it up today, he got no money, no job, no nothing. Living on Tulsa. It's bad. And everybody is saying, your life is sorry. And you know, sometimes, how many know you don't have to have nobody tell you that your life is sorry? It's sorry, it's bad. Sometimes Marco and I crack up because we both had some sorry backgrounds of childhood. And we sit down and do our war stories and see who had the worst. And one day he come up with mayonnaise and sugar sandwich. And the other hand, yes. You remember what that felt like? What that tasted like? Yes. My children don't eat the heel of the bread. I don't think Jessica does either, unless she's still there. They don't eat the edges of the bread. He says, I can't understand that. Then I said, I don't either, because she didn't learn it from me. Because when I was coming up, you ate everything. And 11 kids, and they said it's time to eat. You know, you don't be messing around, because you get the, what's that called, the back of the chicken with the tail spread on. Yeah, I said, I come away from football practice or something, the only thing that's left is that and a neck. The neck of the chicken. So we go with our horror stories back and forth, and we come to the conclusion, man, that was a sorry life. Yes, it was. It was sorry to eat, have to eat like that. Yes, you got to get him to share some of the stuff that he's been through. I have too, so we said sorry. He said, Lord, my life is sorry. And here's what Jabez says. Oh, that thou would do what?
Bless me.
Just bless me.
Hallelujah. Yeah.
So it's your God-given inclination to be blessed. And you have that urge to resist, fight, and be scared of poverty because you should be.
That's right.
It's just not going to do you any good.
That's right.
And here's God's attitude about you and I. 3 John 3, 2 John 3, what is that? Way back there. We heard it so many times. Beloved, above all things, I want you to be what? I want you to prosper. I want you to be blessed. I want you to prosper and be in health, even as I was so prosperous. So Jabez was more honorable than all of his brothers. So that's the distinction, is that he loved God, but he knew that I need to be blessed. I need to be blessed. So starting from zero and sorrow, nothing good spoken about him, nothing good outstanding in his life. Jabez said that, let me look at it one more time. And Jabez called the God of Israel, saying, "Oh, that thou wouldest bless me indeed and enlarge my coast, that thy hand might be with me, and that thou wouldest keep me from evil, that it may not grieve me." And God granted him that which he requested. Keep me from evil? Can I discuss this? Yes, I told Candy, I believe that keep me from evil is that keep me from that bad stuff in life. So that it don't hurt me. And so that's what your man's wanting. Don't let get me away from it and keep me from it so that it don't hurt me. And then we understand that God wants us to be blessed. Praise God. Okay, let me look at some things I wrote down, because I wrote them down in a hurry. So here's the challenge to believers today, is to become an overcomer. To overcome. To overcome our challenges, our situations, the negatives that we have in our lives. You don't need no one to tell you how sorry your life is. You already know, right? So we need to do what? Overcome it.
Amen.
Now, first of all, we have to be convinced that I can overcome it.
Yes.
And then you got to convince yourself that I will overcome it.
That's right.
Praise God. I was talking to Brother Rod yesterday. I said something about mind over matter. He says, how can you run 10 miles? You know, that's a long run. How can you do that? And the first thing out of my mouth was mind over matter. Wow, I don't think a preacher would say something like that. You don't expect the preacher to say, you need the Lord on your side. You need to go pray, you need to go fast, you need to go do all these spiritual things. But how can I do this, dealing with the situation, the mayonnaise and sugar sandwiches, on the way to the steak and potatoes? How can I do that? I'm a cabbie eater. What is it? Kevlar. I gotta get that down. I gotta play the Kevlar. I left the mayonnaise and cheese sandwich some time ago. So how can I get from there to out there? Praise God. And I'm gonna tell you, you better get your mind in order.
That's
right. Mind over matter. Because as you run those laps, you're going to hurt, you're going to feel it, and you know it's there for real, but how do I keep going? Mind over matter. And now God has, he says, let this what? Mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. It's the same mindset that if I set my mind to do it, as Candy was saying, since Irene said she got her mindset. And it doesn't matter about whether it's another sugar sandwich on the way before the steak dinner. It doesn't matter what I got to go through to get there. See, Jessica, she's come over and watch our TV. I said, Jessica, Marco, she'll come over. But I now I know why. Didn't have cable. So, okay, no cable. And I mean, I thought I could almost stretch both hands out, touch everything, the kitchen, the bathroom, the bedroom. back in there when they first got burned, praise God. But they would always, I said, man, they just like us. No, they just come and watch television. So they was preparing themselves, mind over matter, doing without.
That's right.
Doing the uncomfortable thing until they got to the comfortable thing.
Amen.
And that's what it's going to take if you really want to make it with God to where he says, beloved, this is what I want for you all the time, was to be blessed. See, Jabez had to pray, if you would just bless me, if you would just bless me, and enlarge my territory, and just keep me away from that evil stuff, or keep it away so that it won't hurt me, if you just do that. That's everybody's prayer. Lord, if you would just bless me. See, you can't, we can't help nobody, anybody else until you start looking at who? You. You can't be a blessing to the church, the pastor, anybody else until you, like they just alluded to it, until you are in a position to do it. So you got to, we got to get a little bit, someone say a little bit selfish. Oh, come on, a little bit selfish. You don't think you're selfish? Let this church on fire and see who's the first one out. Be in a plane and they drop the oxygen mask. See who's the most important person on the plane. You can't help no one until you help who? You. So you have to set your mind to like a flint. You got to get focused. You got to say, whatever, what is it going to take? But I'm coming off of zero and I'm going to something. Hallelujah. And this is, if God will just bless me. Now we have a capability, we just need to get the mindset to do it, to become an overcomer. I think it's 1 John 5:4-5. Who received that it was an overcomer in this life? John 5:4 says, for whosoever is born of God overcome the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world. What is it? Even our faith. Who's going to overcome the sorrow, the sorry life, the sorrow that I have? Who is he that believeth that Jesus is the Christ? He can overcome it. And that's you and I, love. Verse 5, he that overcometh the world, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God. Hallelujah. Now we're going to go to, I believe it's Ephesians 2nd chapter. No, I'm sorry, let's do James. James 2:22. Have been talking about faith a couple last months or so, and we have to make sure we have a good understanding of that. I mean, we do, we are getting that. And I'm tired of seeing believers church going, tongue talking, hanging from the chandeliers, saints that can't overcome. Now, this is the missing the part, more than likely. He says there, verse 2, and let's go with the verse 17. Even so, faith, if it had not works, is dead, being alone. Yea, and man may say, thou hast faith, I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by what? My works. And Brother Williams is 100% sold out that I only determine if a person has faith by the work that's coming out of their mouth. Hallelujah. You can say, I confess this, I believe that, and I. But I look on the other side of the equation, I'm going to say, I want to see that in that life, that corresponding activity that's matching those words. And then I'll say, that person's going to get what they want. And it's how do you run 10 miles? How do you do it? You got to have that mind over nothing else matters. Mind over matter. My back hurt. I can remember doing that run. My legs hurt. Everything in my body hurt. But I had my mind set that I'm going to go the distance without stopping. And I told Ron, you know, I did not know that when you run that far, that your inner thighs rub together. Anybody ever done that? Took a long distance run? My inner thighs are raw. I don't realize that as I walk normally. But if I walk, I run 10 miles, I know that you better grease up. Because if you're going to go the distance the wrong way, there's some stuff out there that you don't know about.
That's right.
It's going to hurt. It's kind of like riding a horse. You know, if you don't know the real deal about riding a horse, you better talk to somebody. Because you're going to have a hard time sitting down the next day. It's not just going to sit in the saddle and ride. You better know something. If you do that, you're going to have some serious issues. So going the distance, is I know that on the way, it's going to be some discomfort. But it doesn't matter. And I think there's greatness in this church and this body of believers that we just haven't put the mind over it doesn't matter. It just doesn't matter. The other stuff doesn't matter. This is what I'm going after. And Jesus said, it's possible if you believe it. You keep knocking, you keep kicking, you'll get it. So what I'm trying to say to us today is that faith without works is dead. Let's see here. Let's finish up with James 2 and 20. But without know, O man, O vain man, that faith without works is dead. Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seeing then how faith with his work, and by works was faith made what?
Perfect.
By works was faith made perfect. And I just kind of put it like this. Sometimes you might have to fight like a dog to get to what you want. It's not going to come easy. You don't have to put the sacrifices, decline some things, do it out to get to where you want to go. But everybody in here, at one time or another, has said, man, life is sorry. From the block I live in, it's sorry. Or my address is, we're sorry. And that's what Jabez realized. They named me a name that every time I said it, it meant, he's sorry. He's sorry. Look at his background. Look at where we come from. He's sorry. That's what Jabez means, sorry. So you got to say to yourself that, oh Lord, pray to God, if you just bless me, don't worry about nobody else. Just bless me. I'll show you. Glory to God. So, going to Ephesians. I'm going to be getting out of here. Praise God. I think Ephesians, the second chapter. I didn't study to preach. I just studied to share. Would that be okay today?
All
right. I got to learn the hound dog anyway. I'm really practicing. Okay. Hallelujah. Okay, Ephesians 2nd chapter. This is what it says about you and us in our sorry state. And you had he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sin. You who was nothing has he made alive. In times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience, to whom also, we all have our lifestyle